The eye cannot say to the hand,
I have no need of you.
Nor again the hand to the head to the feet, I have no need of you.
On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. And our less respectable members are treated with greater respect.
Whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member,
that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another.
If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you all. About 5 years ago, the elders of this church put together a vision statement. And we, like many organizations across the country, thought it was real cute to say, this is our vision 2020. This was our vision statement 2020, as in, oh, we can see so clear. We know exactly where we're heading in 2020. Well, we did not see this one coming. It has created a bit of an existential crisis, I feel like, individually, as a community, as a country, and as a church. Who are we? How do we remain the body of Christ? How do we serve when we can't go out as much as we would like to go out? When it is so much work to stay connected, how do we stay faithful? The scriptures say that people without vision shall perish. It's like, all right, well, I guess 2020 is a time to make sure we have vision, because everything has had to be analyzed. Everybody has gone into this introspective time of, all right, what do I really desire? What makes me whole? How do we flourish? How do we thrive? And recently a church member said, right now this is just about, our goal is to survive. Which I found to be pretty liberating. It's like, oh yeah, there's another word for that, it's grace. So, you know, before I dive into what I see 2020 or 2021 looking like, soak in that grace. Where, hey, guess what? We're still here, and that's a win. You all have stayed connected, and that's a win. It is okay to just be able to stay together. Normally, we feel like we are heading in the right direction if we are advancing. I mean, that's basically what that means. We're heading in the right direction. And so right now, it's a little hard and tricky to figure out, are we advancing? Because we feel a little stuck as a people. As individuals, you know, when the wagon trains were heading west, yeah, it was scary, but they knew what to do in the morning. When you're hiking the AT, it's a long ways, but you know what you do in the morning. Right now, how we get past or through a pandemic, or how we get to the other side of this, but unless you're working on the vaccine, there's not a whole lot you can do to cut the time on it, right? And so that's disempowering. So that's one of the challenges. Another challenge, Rich Mazingo was talking about, hey, just give me a timeline. I can do anything if you just tell me how long. I can work that 24-hour shift on a fishing boat. I can push hard for a 100-game season, right? Because you know, all right, I can push through this and then I'm gonna get a little break. Well, I think a lot of us had this idea of we're going to push through the first 6 weeks and then 8 weeks And then, all right, June comes around. I still didn't see it as like this state that I had to adjust to, but something to persevere. And then come about August, a bunch of us were like, we're not round in the corner anytime soon. This isn't going to be turned around simply by us doubling down. One reason not everybody was interested in doubling down, but also this virus is that bad. And so I feel like it was then that it made it really a challenge to keep our spirits up. And created a little bit of an existential crisis, because the thing that held things together, how we carry on, came into question, or was seemingly taken away from us. Existentialism, I know that y'all came out, you wanted to hear me talk a little bit about that, so I'm gonna sneak in some existentialism. The rise of existentialism, especially in Europe, was following as the Enlightenment kind of got a hold of most thinking, and as humanity did horrible things to one another, people began to ask themselves, well, what does it mean for us to be human? One author described it as the collapse of the sacred canopy, because prior to this Enlightenment, what held things together was a somewhat universal belief that the divine was driving everything forward, that a kingdom was advancing, and that humanity was getting closer and closer to the kingdom of heaven, and that we could move in that direction. Well, you can see why, after World War II, there was questions about, I'm not sure that we're advancing after the bloodiest century, as well as finally being honest with ourselves, that things like manifest destiny, that we have not treated our brothers and sisters, people as people created in the image of God. So the sacred canopy, for some, seemed to fall in, not able to advance. Here's what I think is sustaining for a community. It's side by side, right? When they're wandering in the wilderness, what keeps them going is the person next to them. How do you persevere knowing that somebody's with you? Rich, I can dig a ditch with you, not knowing how long we're going to be digging a ditch, but as long as me and you are in there together. So the body of Christ is about making sure everybody is still together. I think it is tempting to pull away from the thing that gives you life right now, to pull away from community, because it's actually a lot more work to stay connected right now. But that's where our vitality is. And it also gives us purpose. In the scripture, it says that we've been given these gifts for the common good. For the common good. I need you, Mia. I need you, John Thomas. I need y'all to be able not only to survive, but to thrive. A vision that we see in this scripture is to participate in a divine symphony. How y'all like that? A divine symphony. The common good, that word actually in Greek is from symphiron, which is like, to bring things together. And those things that are brought together are activities given by God, gifts given by God. And your gifts, whatever you bring, has to do with how you can help others experience the divine. And we're stuck with each other. It's kind of the planes, trains, and automobiles sort of thing. we are stuck with each other, and so to try to, it is foolish to think that if we can just pull away and take care of ourselves, we're going to be fine. And so Paul says, you know, that the hand says, I'm not a part of the body. Well, guess what? That didn't make you any less a part of the body. We are each other's life source. The parable of the belly, Paul might have been riffing on this, is where it's a Roman fable in the style of Aesop, and the hand and the mouth and the feet. They say, you know what, the belly's just take. And meanwhile, feet are walking around trying to hunt and gather, and the hand's preparing, and the mouth is chewing, and the belly's just waiting for the food. Feed me. It's like that plant. What's that plant? Audrey too? Yeah, all right. Like that plant. All right. That's the belly. Oh, like that plant. Just sucking up all the life so they can get bigger. And so they're like, all right, we're not feeding that plant. We're not feeding the belly. And then the hand and the feet and the mouth began to weaken. And, of course, what they didn't know or didn't pay attention to was that the belly was actually giving back to them what they needed to survive and thrive. We are a symbiotic body. I need you just as much as you need me. We've been sold a myth, and not just here in America, but around the world, that we can become self-made or independent. But the truth is what makes us human is to be in relationship with one another. So what makes the body of Christ the body of Christ is to participate in the divine energies, these life-giving energies, and make sure that everybody gets a little piece of that. The divine symphony, everybody plays a part, and sometimes you have a very small role, and sometimes you have a large role. Cedric Henson was a pastor at Shepherd's Voice Christian Fellowship Church, and he told a story about when he was a boy, and he was with his father and his older brother, and they were pushing a cart, and it was muddy, and it was a little bit uphill, and the mule was struggling, so his brother was told to get out and help push the cart. And Cedric was too small to really help push the cart, but his dad told him, get out and cog the wheel, so that when they made a little bit of headway, he would cog the wheel. That was his part. I love that it's actually called, that it was cog the wheel, because we use that term as a pejorative, just another cog, you know, in the wheel, just almost being used, just like the hand and the foot and the mouth was talking about the belly, just being used. But a cog in the wheel, hey, guess what? I'm okay being a cog in the wheel. It was about, I think I was in my mid-20s, and I was like, oh, I'm giving up on being great. I just became more realistic about life. I'm like, oh, yeah, no, I'm good with that being great thing. That's more than I'm ready to take on. Instead, I want to be a cog in the wheel. And I decided that a life well lived is a life with love. That a life well lived is participating in the divine with brothers and sisters in Christ, even when it is hard. That's a life well lived, because it's also what we have been created for. If you want meaning, if you want to know who you are, if you want to get through any sort of existential questions, it starts and ends with knowing who you are. Knowing who we are. In the Bible, the communion of faith, it's never about I and me. It is about the body of Christ. And so what I see in 2021, it's actually not that different than what our vision statement said, which was that all will be welcome, that we'll be a church family where all are welcome. Now, at that time, we were opening the doors to people regardless of their sexuality. We still have growing edges to be more diverse racially and socially, economically. But in this year, what it looks like to be welcoming is to make sure people can stay knit together, to make sure that we can stay together. And so that means Zoom, and that means trying to create shepherds and gophers networks. To be a welcoming church family, to show hospitality, is also about wearing masks, making sure that we can all be together in one way or another. The other part of our vision statement was that every member would have a ministry. And that's a struggle. That's more of a struggle. Sometimes it's because people don't want a ministry. Sometimes it's because some of us won't get out of the way and let other people lead or come up with ideas. But right now, one of the biggest challenges is figuring out what ministry looks like. So I would say what a ministry looks like right now is the most simple characteristic of a disciple. At the end, or in the next chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, is where Paul has gone through a litany of different gifts, and he says, faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. So your ministry might be right now to love one another. To love recklessly and with abandon. To witness to a God of love. It's simple. It's a cog. But man, that's what makes it turn, right? As a cog, I might just be love. To embrace that as your ministry, then we know what we're doing here. So brothers, sisters, siblings in Christ, let us love one another that people might see our God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
I need a
designed to sing. Join together in a time of prayer. God, we are gathered to worship and pray, those of us who are here and those of us who are in separate places. We are with you, united in Christ, and part of the communion of all the saints, past, present, and future. In recognition of the vastness of creation and your never-ending creative power, we humbly and confidently speak our heartfelt hurts and share our deepest hopes. We choose to serve you this day, knowing that serving you requires our all. Do not let us falter when discipleship gets hard and we are tempted to serve lesser, easier gods. Encourage us with the gift of community, with the gift of this body, and the power of the Holy Spirit. Help us to not grow weary in doing good. When we survey the state of our world, the suffering and the evil, the conflict and the hardship, we cannot help but cry out to you for help. while we know nothing can separate us from the love of Christ Jesus our Lord, we often rip the fabric of our life together apart, sowing division instead of seeking to be ministers of reconciliation. We know that you are with all those who hurt, and we ask for the courage to stand on the side of the oppressed, to seek out those left half dead in the ditch, and to feed your sheep. Increase, O God, our compassion for people and our compassion for all creation. As we continue to try to navigate the storms of this season, we are mindful that we do not do so alone. We are grateful for the ways you provide for us, granting us glimpses of peace that passes understanding, giving us rest that restores, and pursuing us when we are lost and afraid. We thank you for the gift of one another, those with whom we agree and those whose views we cannot comprehend, each of us your child, made in your image. When we are unsure what to do, where to go, or how we will serve you well, remind us to refill the oil for our lamps, the oil of gladness and healing, the oil that consecrates and anoints, the oil that allows us to see Christ when he comes to meet us. May our desire to serve you provide the wisdom we need for the living of these days. We make our prayer in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Join in singing, Be Thou My Vision.
Oh,
my friends, you're beautiful. You are being invited to participate in a divine symphony. Most of us are triangle players, all right? So be okay with that. Be okay with being a cog, because the cog is love. What makes this life wonderful is that we get to participate in the divine work of God. Teresa of Avila said, yours are the hands with which Christ blesses the world. Yours are the feet with which he walks with compassion. Christ has no body but yours, no hands but yours. Yours is the face with which Christ shines love and grace and hope on the world. That's big. That's big. That's our calling. So when you go out into the world, remember that you are a child of God. Remember that it is the body of Christ that will that will get us through. All right? And go with the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and be at peace. And all God's people said, amen.
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 Please join in singing My Lighthouse.
You are the
Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord face shine upon you. And may you be at peace. Amen.